Hello, everyone. Welcome to our webinar on the brighter future for Siberian cranes. We're glad you're coming in. We'll probably wait just a moment or two to give any other body, a few more people a chance to join. While we're waiting, I will welcome everybody to ICF 50th anniversary. It's a phenomenal celebration for us. And I want to point out our flag line because it's fly together. Every one of you that's here today is part of our team and makes a fabulous distance. So we're not just celebrating what the staff have done, but we're celebrating all of us and looking for a brighter future for us. Okay, there's numbers still going up slightly. I think I will get us rolling. Hannah, next slide, please. Okay, I want to take this opportunity to acknowledge that the International Crane Foundation's headquarters in Baraboo are located within the ancestral homeland of the Ho-Chunk people. I'd like to take the opportunity to acknowledge and honor the Ho-Chunk people as caretakers of the land and water since time immemorial, and as our neighbors, friends, and valued members in our community. I also want to acknowledge that the International Crane Foundation works in so many places around the world that we're dedicated to amplifying the local voice and perspective of the people and the places the crane dance. Before we get started, I'd like to offer a couple of housekeeping notes. We're recording this webinar, and the link will be posted on the website in the coming days if anyone wants to go back or miss this part of it. And also, just to point out, if you have questions, if you look on the bottom of your screen, there's a Q&A function to post your questions for the presenter or our staff. We're going to do our best to get to all your questions by the end of the presentation. There may be some follow-up. If you look, there's also a chat. And I encourage you not to put things there, but to look for that Q&A function specifically. Okay, and I also want to take this moment to honor our webinar sponsors. I had the honor when I first started at ICF in the 80s to travel to Poyang Lake with this fantastic woman called Abigail Avery, who was part of our board. She was there with George the first time that we, quote, discovered the Siberian cranes at Poyang Lake. Of course, they knew they were there and the local people did, but they kept hoping they were there and came over a hill and they saw what George calls the Great White Wall of China with this long, thin string of Siberian cranes feeding at the perfect water depth. Abby's family have stayed connected through her various children and their children. And we're just delighted to have your support and passion for the work that she touched so deeply. If you'd like to learn about sponsoring one of our webinars, we encourage you to contact Kate Fitzwilliams at the number here. Again, 608-617-6002, or writing her at kate@savingcranes.org. Okay, and now I'd like to invite my two other panelists to join us. Jiang Hongxing, our colleague who has put this presentation together, is not able to join us live because it's about 2 in the morning in China. So we thank him for the phenomenal work he put into preparing this and recording it for us. And he sends his appreciation and to everyone here. Hongxing has worked with ICF for 20 years, more than 20 years. He'll tell you a little bit about how he first encountered us. He's a deputy director of a laboratory at the National Bird Banding in China, which is part of the Chinese Academy of Sciences. He first joined us. He's a phenomenal scientist who sponsored many students, but through a project called the UNEP, GEF Siberian Crane Wetland Project, where he worked 10 years as the main technical advisor for China. And since then, we have another 10-year grant from the Disney Conservation Fund. And he has been one of our key researchers, with most of his focus on Northeast China, but also throughout the flyway into Poyang Lake. It's been an honor to work with him. He's a great pleasure. He's brilliant. And the work you're hearing about, Hongxing had a lot of the lead, but it was supported and co-organized by ICF. And again, together, we're now looking at, so we're coming to the end of the Disney grant. What have we learned? What does it tell us about what the needs are and what's working and what's not working? And to use this to inform us on what we need to do next to ensure this brighter future for Siberian cranes. And before we start the presentation, I'd like to invite Crawford Prentice, who's going to be moderating the system, to introduce himself.
Yes, hi everybody. Thank you very much, Claire. This is a great pleasure to be moderating here today. I first knew Hongxing when he was working on the GF Siberian Crane Wetland Project. And I was also involved in the same project. This was back in about 2000. So that was the first time I met with Hongxing. And we worked together, you know, throughout the period of that Siberian Crane project, which finished eventually at the end of 2009. And then also I had another chance after that to work with him on a wetland adaptation planning project on two of the key sites that he mentions during his presentation in Northeast China. At Momager and Tumiji nature reserves. So this was an attempt to try to help the nature reserves adapt their wetland management towards, you know, the realities of climate change as it's slowly taking effect. That's my kind of background. I worked in the Siberian Crane project, say, for about 10 years. I also had a bit of a role in designing that original project. After a gap of sort of about 10 years of working as an independent consultant, now I'm back with ICF again. This time I'm the vice president for Asia programs, and so China and you know, the flyway of the Siberian cranes from China all the way up to Arctic Yakutia in eastern Russia and the north. That's all part of that, and it's very exciting to see this presentation today and to be able to participate in it. So thank you, Claire. Yeah.
Okay, thanks. And then Zhiwei, could you power up and introduce yourself? This is one of my co-panelists and who's got some great expertise. He'll be helping me answer some of your questions. Go ahead, Zhiwei.
Hi, everyone. My name is Guo Zhiwei. Thanks, Claire. And I used to work in Northeast China for ICF China program to do the crane survey and environmental education. And I used to work with Dr. Jiang Hongxing to organize our crane synchronized survey in Northeast of China. And now I'm doing my master project in Louisiana State University under Dr. Sammy Jing about hydrology and the wetland ecosystem in coastal Texas. And I also hope to help our wetland research and management in China. So thanks. Thank you.
Thank you, Zhiwei, and thank you, Crawford. Okay, I'm going to power off. Let's enjoy Hongxing's presentation, and we'll be back shortly.
Dear distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. I'm Jiang Hongxing from National Bird Binding Center of China. It's my pleasure to be here to give this speech. My topic is working together for a bright future for Siberian cranes. First of all, I would like to introduce my relationship with International Crane Foundation. In July of 2000, when I just got my master's degree, I traveled with George Archibald to Tibet for binding of black-necked crane. It's this time get me into the crane family. After them, I worked as the National Technical Coordinator for the Siberian Crane GF project. At that moment, I meet with Jim Harris, Crawford Prentice, Claire Mirande. Then in 2011, I meet with Rich Belfer in Dalong National Nature Reserve for the Red Crown Crane. After them, I meet with Sammy, Li Qin, John, and the other scientists of US. So my topic includes 6 parts. First one is historic and current status of Siberian cranes. The second one is population dynamics and conservation gaps. The third one is enrollment carrying capacity of nature shallow wetland. The fourth is the ecological response and adaptation to the changing environment. The fourth one is conservation-based wetland zonation and adaptive management. And the sixth part is the impacts and challenges of crane conservation in China. So for the crane family, a total of 15 crane species in the world, but 2/3 crane species are globally threatened species. It also, the crane family is the most threatened family of birds in the world. For the Siberian cranes, you can see the left picture, the serrated bill, and also in the front is very soft. This feature is adapted for probing for tubers and roots of wetland plants. Second, the Siberian crane is the most aquatic of the cranes and mainly feed on the vegetables, but in breeding season, they also feed on some animal foods. In the history, there are 3 subpopulations of Siberian cranes. And right now is only the eastern population, almost the major remaining flyway population. And also is the longest migration of any crane species. Due to the climate change and homing activities, so the Siberian cranes facing the huge threats and IUCN Red List recognized it's the critically endangered species in 2000. Right now, the eastern population accounted for almost the whole global population. The migration distance is about 5,500 kilometers. We can see this video. The migration routes like the 8 sheep and also from the migration pattern, the Songlin Plain and the Liao River Plain of Northeast China are identified as a critically important staging areas. It's like the bottleneck location. And the other information about the eastern population is the Siberian cranes has very high set fidelity in breeding ground, but in staging area and wintering ground, the turnover rate is very, very high. This slide shows the main fault of Siberian cranes in the staging or stopover areas and wintering area. So mainly feed on the nature sub-imagined plants. There are 2 sacrifices during the stopover migration period. So our question is, how to secure the sustainability of shallow wetlands for migratory Siberian cranes. So we need to know the spatial and temporal distribution and also the population dynamics. The second one, we need to know habitat carrying capacity of the shallow wetland. The third one, we need to know the key staging areas along the flyway. The fourth one is how to design the wetland zonation and plan the adaptive management in response to the climate change. So to get this answer, we did the synchronized survey in 21 areas. So the left picture showed the location of a synchronized survey, which included Songlin Plain, 7 areas, and 7 areas in Liao River Plain, and 7 areas in North China Plain. So our survey area covered over 1 million hectares, including 7 national nature reserves, 1 national wetland park, 8 provincial nature reserves, and 5 non-protected areas. From this synchronized survey, we can see the total population of Siberian cranes is unstable in different surveys, but the highest count over 5,000. So this number also updated the global population estimate of Siberian cranes. The red slides show the population dynamics of some stopover and staging areas. So we can see the red color area. The Songlin Plain and the Liao River Plain are most important staging areas. Meanwhile, we also did the intensive monitoring in 4 key staging areas, include Momoge, Shanghai, Wolong Lake, and Huazhong. The left 2 pictures showed the fixed monitoring points in Momoge and Wolong Lake, and the right picture showed the population dynamics in the different migration season. So this slide shows the foraging habitat change under the increasing water variability. So for the left bottom pictures, we can see in March 21st, there are still some shallow water in the wetlands. So around 200 Siberian cranes and so many geese, ducks used that area. But just 1 month later, the shallow water disappeared and the birds, cranes disappeared as well. So for this wetland, it's quite sensitive to the climate change. And the right pictures we can see, even the water dry out, but we can see very clearly about the deep hole in the ground. This slide shows the Siberian crane used the shallow wetlands for feeding the tubers of 2 scrapers. And this slide is like an aerial photo. So not only Siberian cranes, but so many other ducks and geese, and also the white-napped crane and Eurasian crane. So how about the habitat use in the staging area? We did the analysis based on the synchronized survey. With the prolongation of spring and fall migration season, the Siberian crane increased to use the corn field. Accordingly, the Siberian crane increased to use the staging area outside of the existing protected area. So this change was largely associated with the fluctuation of hydrology condition in shallow wetland of staging area. And in the later spring and early fall of 2021, the ratio of cranes in the non-protected area reached to 78 and 61. So this slide shows the Siberian crane feed on the corns in the agriculture field. And this slide shows in November of 2021, when a sudden blizzard happened in northeast China and the temperature decreased, just one day decreased over 15 degrees. So to make this crane species safety in that area, the local volunteers provide the corn to feed the Siberian cranes. Meanwhile, we also did the satellite tracking to better understand the migration pattern of Siberian cranes. In this moment, I would like to share one story about the Siberian cranes with the longest tracking time. So this Siberian cranes was captured and deployed with the tracking devices on October 27, 2017. So far, it has been tracked for over 5.5 years. Right now, the crane has completed 5 complete migrations in spring and 4 seasons. And in the winter of 2020, I mean just 3 years later, this crane with his baby was photographed in Poyang Lake Basin. And then, in the winter of this year, we also checked the crane carry additional baby back to Poyang Lake for wintering. So another amazing record created by this crane in fall of 2021. The crane can flew 37 hours and 1,100 miles without any stop. Based on the satellite tracking data, we also did the analysis about the distribution of important staging areas. So the results are quite consistent with the results from the synchronized surveys. Important staging areas include Mobuga, Tumuji, and the surrounding area of Songlin Plain, eastern Kurchin sandy land, Wolong Lake, Huandong of Liao River Plain, Yellow River Delta of North China Plain. In addition, the migration strategy of most bird species is to minimize migration time in spring, so then they can reach to the breeding ground in a short time and occupy the better breeding habitats. But the Siberian Crane take the strategy, the opposite strategy. That means in spring, the migration time is longer than in autumn. This may related to the poor food condition in the wintering ground or in the staging areas. Meanwhile, we also did the conservation gaps analysis. So Siberian cranes are spending much more time at stopover and resting site outside of the existing protected areas. So we reached the question how to mitigate conflicts between the crane conservation and agriculture production. Second one is how to maintain the wetland function and resilience for migratory Siberian crane in the existing protected areas. How to mitigate the challenge? Our question is, how large an area of shallow wetland habitat is needed in stopover or staging areas can ensure the Siberian cranes can replenishment their energy requirements? So we did the environment carrying capacity of a nature shallow wetland by Siberian cranes. So case study is in the outpower wetland at Mobugan Nature Reserve. From 2009 to 2012, almost all migratory Siberian cranes docked at outbound wetlands in both migration seasons. So from the picture, we can also very clearly to see after 2012, the population decreased very fast. We used the ground survey to simulate the tuber density of food plants in outpower wetlands. So the results showed the food production can still meet the food requirements of Siberian cranes in outpower wetlands. Well, was used by Siberian cranes from 2008 to 2011. The area is just 4,000 hectares. So that means if we can maintain a wetland of 2,000 hectares very well, we can ensure almost half of migratory population of Siberian cranes get the enough energy during the migration season. To maintain the outbound wetlands function and sustainable, so we did the remote sensing of water depths. The result can help the local managers to control the water level and also to know how volume water needed when the water level make changes. This slide shows a newer precipitation and temperature of Songlin Plain. So we can see the water condition is quite different among the years. So how to know the ecological response and adaptation of Siberian cranes to this change of environment? So from the red picture, we can see the Siberian cranes spent 1 6 of year in the staging areas of Songlin Plain and Liao River Plain. So this slide shows the land cover change in Momogo from 1984 to 2011. The wetland decreased almost two-thirds decreased. But in the different stage, the wetland conversion is quite different. And this slide shows the land cover change in Shanghai National Nature Reserve. The wetland decreased in the past 30 years, almost half loose. And this is the land cover change of Huanzhidong of Liao River Plain from 2000 to 2019. The area of the water body got larger and the amount of shallow wetland available for cranes decreased from 23% to 5%. We also did the simulation of the Huanzhidong wetland bottom terrain. So from this slide, we can see the water level keep the 1.2 and 1.3 is more suitable for maintain the large area of shallow wetland. This slide shows the land cover change of Wolong Lake. For this lake, I would like to emphasize one dune. We call it the L-shaped dune. So between 2012 and 2015, the local government removed the L-shaped dune. After them, no birds, just water and fish. And after, the local government recognized the L-shaped dune is quite important for creating the shallow wetlands for water birds. So in 2016 and 2017, they reconstructed the dam. After them, the Siberian crane returned back. Also, we did the movement pattern for the Siberian cranes in the wintering ground. So we try to understand the movement pattern of Siberian cranes between the high water years and normal water years. So from this picture, we can know for the green column is the normal water years. So generally, the size of daily home range and also the movement distance are significantly smaller in normal water years than that in high water years. So based on these results, we found the energy consumption is higher in agriculture field than that in nature habitat at daily movement distance and also home range area is significantly longer and larger than in agriculture fields. We also did the gut microbe diversity and physiological response under different foraging habitats in wintering ground. Actually, we also did in spring migration season and also for migration season. So this picture just showed the field sampling teams in the different habitats. the result showed for the macro diversity, the highest is the nature wetlands. Second one is lotus pond. The third one is paddy fields. But for the amino acid, nucleotide, carbohydrate, transport, and metabolism is the opposite. Meanwhile, the HA and corticosterone has the same change trend. Nature wetland is higher than lotus pond and higher than paddy fields. So based on this result, we can see the nature habitat is more benefit to the wintering Siberian cranes than the agriculture field. Based on the former results, how can we manage the wetlands used the limited resources under the different water conditions? So we did the conservation-based wetland zonation and adaptive management plan for the different staging areas. So from this slide, especially for the right picture, we can see the wetland unit of different priority. Dark color is high priority, and the light color is a low priority. In addition, we also did the wetland zonation with different priority, and also with the emphasis on the different water bird group, like breeding water birds, migratory water birds, and for both groups, for Shanghai and Momogo as well. So in this study, we can inform the local manager, the wetland units, how many wetland units with the higher management priority. This slide shows the plan for the different area. First one is for Momogo. Second, the middle one is for Shanghai. And for the right one is for the Western Songlin Plain. And this slide showed the water level change affect the plants change. So the left two pictures was taken in 2011. And in that moment, it's just the shallow water and some supported plants. So many Siberian cranes and water birds used the wetland. For the right two pictures, which were taken in 2016, the same location, but a different landscape, and almost no Siberian cranes and even other water birds. So how to use the limited water resources to manage the wetlands for Siberian cranes? So we proposed the adaptive management of stopover wetland habitat at different spatial scales. We employed the migration network conservation approach and considered the stopover habitat management at a unit, site, region, and flyway scales. We also adopted the adaptive management measures based on the nature hydropowers. Also, we improved the structure of water infrastructures and water condition controls. The last part is the impacts and challenge of crane conservation in China. For the impacts, we promoted construction of three national parks. One is Songlin Crane National Park. Second one is Liao River Estuary National Park. And the third one is Yellow River Estuary National Park. And we converted 20,000 hectares farmland into the wetland in Momogo and Shanghai National Nature Reserves. Complete the resettlement of about 10,000 residents from core and buffer zones of Shanghai National Nature Reserve. For Shanghai Reserve, it also acquired the land management right of over 14,000 hectares of wetlands. For Tumuji National Nature Reserve, the local government constructed the water supply canal from Tao River to the wetland with a length of 70 kilometers in 2017. And for Tumuji, Momogo, Shanghai, and Wolong Lake, in dry years of 2017 and 2018, they implemented water supply to maintain the wetlands sustainable and resilience. And for Yellow River Delta, the reserve accomplished wetland restoration of over 30,000 hectares. So this achievement are under the implementation of crane conservation projects in China. And this impacts also improve the wetland condition and increase the wetland resilience. So the next one is the challenges of crane conservation in China. First one is conflicts between crane conservation and agriculture lose or damage. So the second one is how to improve the management efficiency of the existing protected areas. That means how to manage the nature habitat and also the agriculture habitat in the current protected areas. So in this way, then can mitigate the conflicts between the current conservation and the community livelihood. The third one is how to evaluate the impact of agriculture foods on the crane health. And the next one is how to assess the risk of migration network connectivity under the climate change and human disturbance. And this slide shows the new food for Siberian cranes in this winter. They feed the wild rice streams, not only in Poyang Lake Basin, but also in the middle and lower reaches of Yangtze River in China in this winter. And this slide is fed on the sanding growers. So we don't know what's the major role of the sandy growers. It helps the digest coarse fibers of food or supply calcium. So this is my presentation. Finally, I would like to thank for these agencies and organizations for their support resources support, via the International Crane Foundation, Disney Conservation Fund, National Forestry and Grassland Administration, Ministry of Science and Technology of People of China, and the Chinese Academy of Forestry, and my institute, and the National Botanic Center of China, and the Northeast Institute of Geography and Agriculture Ecology, Chinese Academy of Sciences. Thank you for their support. So, finally, for crane conservation, there's still a long road to get out of the woods. Let us continue to work together for a bright future for Siberian cranes. That's all. Thank you so much for your attention, support, and concern. Thank you.
Well, so that's the presentation. Sorry, Claire, you're going to say something? No. Okay, well, thank you for your attendance today. And so now we've got a bit of time for questions, about 15 minutes or so. And so that was a wonderful presentation by Dr. Jiang Hongxing. So it's a great pity he couldn't be here because of the time difference for this webinar. So he's not here in person and wouldn't be able to take direct questions. But we're going to do our best to field whatever questions we can. And so Claire and Zhiwei will be trying to respond to some of the questions. If you do have questions, we'd like to request you put them in the Q&A rather than the chat on the side. But we'll try to catch the other ones too as best we can, okay? So first, I just want to go to one of the earlier questions in the Q&A, which is, what is the current population of Siberian cranes? So I'd like to pass that one to Zhiwei, if you'd like to comment on that.
Thanks for the question. We count about 5,521 Siberian cranes with 759 juveniles in 2020 November. I think Jiang Hongxing showed his result in his slide. So Siberian crane population is keep increasing in recent few years. So some people think now, last year, Siberian crane is more than 6,000. So, yeah.
And Crawford, I'll just add too that it's what's significant is 10 years ago, we started the Disney project. There was an estimate of about 3,600 birds. So we honestly believe these conservation efforts are having some impact and that there is growth. You know, some of it might be better counting methods, but that there is real growth. But at the same time, we realize how big the challenges are. You know, they all winter at Poyang Lake in China, and there's a good chance there's going to be a water outlet dam put in there, which they're hoping to manage to keep the ecosystem functioning, but it's so complex, it's going to be very hard. So, and you know, Hongxing laid out a lot of what we learned, but there's a lot more to do. So anyway, the increase in numbers is great, but it also reminds us we need to keep on our toes.
Okay, thank you both, Zhiwei and Claire. It's probably also worth mentioning that the Siberian crane remains a critically endangered crane in terms of the IUCN Red List. And, you know, these ratings are established through, you know, very detailed scientific assessments, drawing information from many sources. So, you know, these are periodically repeated just to make sure that the assessments are up to date. But I think the current assessment does reflect the level of risk affecting the Siberian cranes despite the conservation progress. So I just add that. Okay, thank you very much. Right, okay, so we've got another question here. Are Siberian cranes at risk for avian influenza? So quite an important background here. I mean, avian influenza, particularly the highly pathogenic strain that's currently prevalent across much of the world, actually, has been a severe risk for birds. I'm going to pass this on to Claire now, if you'd like to comment on the case of Siberian cranes.
Okay. Where we're finding the cranes are most at risk is when there's high concentrations. Like with soil loss, the Eurasian cranes in the Hula Valley at 8,000, and the hooded cranes and where they're artificially fed and zooming. Siberian cranes have some benefit in that they have been more scattered. But right now, with climate change, we've seen extreme weather years. This year, we had a big drought this fall. So the natural food production was low, which caused the birds to look for alternate food. One of the places they go are lotus ponds, and that are put there for the Siberian cranes, but so many of them come in at the same time, up to 2,000 birds feeding in these concentrated ponds. Also, they're concentrating more in a few agriculture fields that we've paid to have protected for them, that farmers leave rice. But so there are things you can do to try and get them to scatter out, but fortunately, and it's moved around by different birds, it's moved around in domestic poultry, so it could show up in those areas. But we have people, you know, very high surveillance, and the government of China, you know, was ready to step in and take what actions are possible. But mostly it's just keeping the birds dispersed is a key factor in reducing that risk.
Okay, thank you very much, Claire, for that response. Okay, I've got another one here. What impact does pesticide and herbicide use have on the Siberian cranes? So this, I think, has been, it's in the chat there. And I think some of the relevance here is that, you know, the Siberian cranes are traditionally very much wetland dependent cranes, the most wetland dependent of all the crane species, I think. But now there's a trend for them to, as we heard in the presentation, for these birds to start moving out of the wetlands and feeding in adjacent agricultural lands. Without maybe Zhiwei, would you like to comment on this one? What impact do you think the pesticide herbicide use might have on the Siberian cranes around these staging areas?
Yeah, since 2013, we start to observe that Siberian cranes start to go out of the wetland and use the cornfield in northeastern China, and you know, the farmer just bought the corn seed with the pesticide outside. So they plant the seed in the soil. The Siberian crane can just go to eat, and which is a threat to their health. And we think it's you know, some few death cases, but we don't observe too many deaths, Siberian crane deaths, because of this. And some people think Siberian crane can avoid this kind of corn seed because they know it is poisonous. So, yeah.
Hey, yes, and Crawford, I'd like to add some notes. The Siberian crane is a little safer than other species because it's primarily aquatic, and it's eating seeds that often in the fall. So the biggest risks are when the seeds are planted in the spring and they're just shooting and they're easily pulled out as seeds. It's not the leftover that falls after harvest. But there have been reported deaths of other species of cranes, like red crowns and white-naped cranes. The farmers are not trying to hurt the cranes in most cases. They're just trying to keep the invertebrates from killing their crop. So the cranes accidentally have problems, but we don't know how much it is. And it's because the red crown and white-naped crane have declined so much in the past decades. The Western population is down, say, from 3,000 to less than 1,000, and 2,500 red crowns to about 300. So we are concerned that part of the factor might be adult mortality, and this could be one of the factors. The other reason that some cranes die from poisoning is that hunting is illegal. Most people, no guns are allowed, but people will put out poison grains to illegally take ducks or geese to eat or to sell in the market. Again, we don't know how much, but we know it does occur. And sometimes the cranes find those piles of poison seed. So periodically we'll find a die-off. It also happened, someone was interested in demoiselle cranes throughout a range. So poisoning, usually accidental, can be a real concern. But fortunately, Siberian cranes are a little lower risk.
Okay, thank you very much. I think that's a fairly comprehensive answer. Okay, we've got another rather different one. How have the massive fires in Siberia affected crane populations and migration patterns? So, Claire, can I test you with that one?
Sure. Again, our time's getting a little shorter. The fires up in the Arctic have overlapped with the Siberian crane breeding range. There were phenomenal responses of leveraging people to control them. Fortunately, it did not impact so much on the nest success. It was slightly different areas. And it happened early enough in the year that it didn't force them to leave on migration early. So far we've been lucky. There's people in there, though, studying the effects on plant and other species, and there is risk that they could occur again in the future.
Okay, thank you.
And according to our survey, we observed so many juveniles in north of China in recent 2 or 3 years. So I think their breeding, they have a high breeding success in their breeding habitat. So, yeah.
Right, thank you. Okay, so maybe just we've got time for one more question maybe. I've got one here. How has Russia's participation in this project been? So stepping a bit away from the presentation directly here, but of course, you know, the Siberian cranes breed in Far Eastern Siberia, so the Russians are very much involved. And maybe Claire, would you like to just comment on that?
Yeah, this could be another webinar. The Russians have all of the breeding birds. They've upped the protection of the breeding area, which is very huge and remote, but have like millions of hectares in what's now Kitalik National Park. It was partly unprotected, now went to provincial and federal level protection. They've got good staff and long-term research going on. So there's a serious commitment. And there also is a very good, they continue their work. We used to be able to give them extra support, which is hard right now. But there is a sister site relationship with Point Lake with all the Siberian cranes winter. So we're very pleased to see this increased collaboration between the breeding and wintering areas along the flyway.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, that's right. The Russian collaboration has been quite special, I think. And hopefully we can continue it productively going forward. That'd be great. Okay, maybe just one more if we have time.
Hannah, you call it when you need to. We have a few closing slides.
All right. Okay.
So yeah, let's take one more.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Right. So we've got one here. How do you catch the cranes to mark them? Zhiwei, would you like to comment on that one?
I haven't participated with the crane catching with Dr. Jiang Huxing, but Dr. Jiang Huxing told me the he set up a trap in the wetland and catch a bird. This is what I know.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
It's a lot trickier because they're so aquatic. So but our Chinese team, for years we were not successful, have come up with different ways. And we can always get more information if someone has some interest to collaborate.
Yeah. So the short answer is it's quite challenging.
Yeah.
Okay, that's great. So I think maybe we'll stop there. And so thanks everybody for your questions. I'm sorry, there are one or two more we didn't quite get to there, but I think we've covered most of them. I'll hand back to Claire just for a few closing remarks. Sure. Okay.
Okay, next I would like to draw attention to our next webinar, which is being done by Sergei and Elena Smirensky, who started our program at Moravyovka Park in Russia. They're going to be talking about the three decades of the park's activities to preserve cranes and wetlands in the Amur River Basin. And that will be on April 20th at 11 a.m. And it's sponsored by the Friends of Moraviovka Park. And I just also want to acknowledge that this presentation, our work, are only made possible because we have supported people like you. I want to thank everyone here for either being a member or supporting us or following our work. And I want to just go back to the opening thing or this logo under our 50th year anniversary, which is again, fly together. And it's because all of us are part of this. You know, your support lets the people at ICF support people, people like Zhiwei, to be doing the real work out in the field. And we couldn't do it without flying together. And so we hope you will consider continuing to support our work. And thank you from the bottom of our hearts.